moving on, some of the e-commerce numbers, since all the audience is very relevant today, and I'll not dive into anything, but we are consistently seeing the growth anywhere from 15% to 20% year over year. And in next decade or so, this growth is going to be continued because only 10 to 15% of the retail has been moved to e-commerce, where the industry experts say the possibility or opportunity is it can go as high as 60 to 70%. So I think next few decades, we are continuing to see this progress. So in 2017, the worldwide e-commerce sales is going to touch somewhere $2.35 trillion to $2.5 trillion. So really, with some of the data I have shared, the one thing is very clear to all the industry leaders, especially the marketers, merchants, that big data is going to transform really the grid-based e-commerce. Whether the display advertising, what it is going to do, or should I put a banner or a boarding board on the roadside, to really data-driven e-commerce where everything is measured and what works, what doesn't work, you can feed it back and then the system can learn and can do the right thing for your e-commerce company. So really, some of the data around what is impact on e-commerce from big data. So the company which uses predictive analytics achieved over 70% higher sales. These are huge numbers. We are not talking about 10-15% gain. We are talking about pretty much 100% gains. 65% of consumers feel completely frustrated with bad customer experience. If you look only the millennials, that number becomes 70-80%. So the new generation, they are demanding really a seamless experience. Personalization is going to be the key. So when it comes to upsell and cross-sell, almost personalization helps you selling 70% more. And it is growing. And pretty much the way the news comes to you, the way your social media look like, Facebook or Twitter, you choose everything what you are going to see. Same thing for e-commerce. Everything is catered to just you. And again, the reality of the market, only 20% of the drugs are seen positively impact people's lives. So this is really a huge messaging problem, content problem, and all these brands need to really worry and do something about it. So I'll dive into, again, a little bit of the history and all the revolutions we have seen over last few decades. So 1990-2000, that wave of internet happened. That was the first wave. And it really pretty much disrupted everything. The retail became e-commerce, any industry, you name it. Has a huge influence. The second wave was mobile internet, which enabled the real-time, anytime, anywhere access of information, and now transaction and everything. By 2010, more than 10 billion devices were already connected to internet. The third wave, the Internet of Things, which is really fueling the whole e-commerce, sorry, the big data growth. This was like really the physical and digital convergence where your refrigerator, your washing machine, your thermostat, your door locks, they're all talking to each other and doing things and creating a lot better life for everybody. And now the fourth wave, the AI and robotics, and you name it, people are saying that it is going to disrupt every industry, whether it is real estate, whether it is healthcare, whether it is e-commerce, whether it is travel, everything is going to reshape. And as I said, when we think the fourth web, AI and robotics, really bringing back to the e-commerce, I love to understand what is there for e-commerce. And really, when we are looking at all these buzz with the AI and machine learning, and this is nothing new. AI and machine learning, I remember, and I should not share all these numbers, but almost 20 years ago when I was in school, I took a class. So it was there. It has been there for the last 5 or 6 decades. And all of a sudden, everybody's talking about it. 5 years before, there was hardly any word out there in the market. So what happened in last couple of years, why AI and machine learning all of a sudden became so hot. And Deepak has done a lot of work in machine learning and AI, along with the semantic web, sentimental analysis, and so on. But I'd really love to understand from Deepak, what's changed recently?
So, hello, first of all, thank you very much for the lightning. Certainly made a lot of sense. Things have been evolving fast. The transformation that make it that change. So, you're right. I mean, what we learn, I remember going to the class together about intelligence. 20 years ago, the technologies, algorithms, they're pretty much the same. In fact, some of the algorithms what we are implementing, they've been there for 23 years, 20, 30 years. Nothing has changed. So the past, what had fell short is not the design or software, but the required foundation and infrastructure that is needed to build this useful AI system. In short, the biggest difference between AI then and now is that necessary computational capacity with the skill and the raw volume of data, which you talk about, the big data part, and the processing speed. And I remember those days, a decade ago, not less than a decade ago, when we worked together. I mean, I used to spend like hundreds of dollars and money for time to set up a machine. And today with AWS and Azure, you see that you can spawn a nano machine just in $4.75 per month. You know, that goes in not even cents, less than a cents per hour. And you can spawn those hundreds of machines on a click. I can spawn those hundreds of machines from while I'm driving my car. And with this IoT, digital transformation, big data you mentioned, it's all possible to process the unstructured data. And here we are giving us data, not teachable machine. Those days, I remember four or five years ago when I was working on the sentimental analysis for the Twitter feed and all that. Even that time, you know, I mean, it was started working. But way before, if you go, I mean, the data wasn't there. And it was so difficult to parse that unstructured data. Now, I mean, it's you don't even need to implement many of those algorithms. They're just out of the shell. You see that many of the companies like Google, Amazon, and Microsoft, and IBM, they came up with the implementation of those algorithms, like, you know, TensorFlow, you might have heard, or many other, you know, IBM Watson and all that. So it's become pretty democratized nowadays. So I think the main three things, I would say, the amount of data is available now, the processing power we have, and the computational capability of doing this.
So yeah, so the whole data issue and the infrastructure, that's what I'm hearing, like really the key things. So really, I mean, when we look at AI and machine learning, there are so many definitions, right? Then they call it like, this is weak AI, this is strong AI, this is suggestive, this is, I mean, could you just shed some light? I mean,
You ask this question to different people. It's more like, you know, nowadays, because it has become a buzzword, you ask somebody a big data or the cloud, and people have their own definition. But again, I'll go with my definition, which I think it is, and maybe I try to put it a little simplified for e-commerce perspective. So along with it, fundamentally, what I think, AI is an effort to build a machine that's like a new, simple. Artificial intelligence, and that's a bit fundamental. Can we reach to the human intelligence? More so that can make the judgment, make decision for you. And beyond that, just the job that has been instructed. And fundamentally, when we go back, many people actually get confused with AI and automation. Automation is you program the machine and you expect the machine to perform the job, which otherwise human would be doing. But you don't expect them to make the decision or take the, you know, prediction or do any kind of semantic work. Where in the AI, you expect that. So, I mean, say in AI world, we expect machine to be intelligent, have intelligence. Intelligence that not only enable machine to do the job, but learn itself from the existing environment. And that learning is that what we refer to as machine learning. I mean, you generally hear these two words on and off, AI and then machine learning. Many times people don't understand what is machine learning. The learning part which machine needed to be intelligent is machine learning. So now the question is, what is machine learning, right? in detail. So as I said, the machine is able, its ability to learn from existing data without being explicitly programmed. In machine learning, we develop software programs that teach themselves to grow and change as they are exposed to new data. Many times I see machine learning is like data mining, you know, where algorithm is actually looking to find the pattern in the, you know, scattered data. And when the pattern is found, they change the action. So let me tell you a little bit, a few more jargons you would hear when you talk to AI engineers, you know, that, you know, they'll say that, hey, no, we are doing actual supervised learning, unsupervised learning, something like that. So reinforcement learning, another word, I mean, because of driving cars, self-driving cars are becoming more and more popular, this reinforcement learning. So three jargons I want you to know this. One is the supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and semi-supervised learning. So what is supervised learning? Supervised learning, the computer is given desired input and output, and the goal is to learn. And the goal is to learn general rules from the combination. So you give, okay, these are the, you know, mountains. These are the oceans. So you label them. You feed into machine, and then you give another data set and expect them to actually return the result to you. So basically, you label the data. That's called labeled data. So you'll hear another term like labeled data, training data, learning data, all that's nothing but used in the supervised learning to train machine in, or to a machine to identify the pattern, and so the machine can make the rules out of it. And I mean, the typical example of supervised learning, if you see, you know, I would say in a handwriting recognition, a speech recognition, all those image recognition, they use supervised learning. Unsupervised learning, where is that? You don't give any training data to the machine. I mean, it's just a blank. What you do, you just throw data on them and let the machine discover the pattern. There's something very common algorithm is used as K-learn, clustering algorithm. And what you do, you throw the data and you identify the cluster and you find that what is the most common thing, most common pattern in the data. Or sometimes it's used for the anomaly detection, like for example, fraud detection. You have a certain pattern going on, and suddenly somebody does something which never happened before. So the machine automatically identifies that something abnormal happened, and it identifies and raises a flag. So that's what is kind of unsupervised learning. You're telling nothing, machine not know anything, but it detects from the pattern or the clusters. So that's unsupervised learning. So we need to do another webinar actually to go in detail of these, and I think this is the subject of my choice. Secondly, I should have one more. We have our CTO, Rahul Shah, who is absolutely expert in this area too. So certainly we should have more in detail. But let me end this with one thing is that most common learning today is the hybrid, and that's called semi-supervised. So what you do, you neither leave the machine and completely spending time and money into creating the data, learning data, and neither you leave the machine to determine everything. What do you want? You want machine to learn faster and produce best results. So what do? You actually combine. And the supervised learning data is costly actually. And you know that in the part of the EasyVIA, we have crowd, many of our clients actually use our crowd to create the, you know, learning data. So those are the things, So yeah, certainly, I will be available to more webinars, to go a little more detail, but I think, I hope that makes some sense.
Absolutely. So, I mean, this is what I like to just summarize, which I understood. Of course, beside all this definition, so when you talk about machine learning, basically a machine which can learn itself without explicitly being programmed. And when it comes to AI, the generalized AI, where it can start behaving like a human, might be a thing of distance, but at least in specific areas, without going in any definition, like whether you call it a translation or something, it is already there, right? So that's how we believe it is going to disrupt all these areas. So bringing back the attention to the e-commerce, so we discussed digitization, we discussed the big data, and now the AI movements, and which will go more in the detail, will disrupt many areas of e-commerce. So let's pick one area, the content, the biggest problem of e-commerce. And I mean, from the pictures itself is very clear. When somebody goes to your e-commerce or your online store and look for red Nike shoe, and basically if they don't see the relevant inventory, or even if they go to the right product, but the product doesn't give them enough information, what kind of shoe is there, what kind of sole is there, what kind of material and all that, basically the customer do not have enough data to make the buying decision, and they end up on your competitor. And here are some of the numbers which has been produced by a short form market survey. And when we look at the content, the poor content, more than 30% consumer abandoned the shopping cart, online shopping cart, due to the poor content. More than 40% customers end up returning items because it was not described well. And more than 87% of the consumer end up losing loyalty of your brand, and many of them say, like, I will never shop at this ever. And this is not a new problem. I mean, this problem has been there for almost 20, 25 years since the e-commerce started evolving. Why it is not solved? And that's also not true. It has been solved to some extent. So let me go in the problem quickly. It's a very big problem. If you talk about a mid-market e-commerce, you're talking several hundred thousand SKUs. If you're talking large enterprise, it could be 10 to hundreds of million SKUs. And every other day, new SKUs are coming. So these are very recurring in nature, very time consuming, and very expensive to create a really good content. Even if you say, okay, it will cost me $30 to $50 per item, for $10 million, you're talking several hundred million dollars of expense. Nobody has that kind of money. And it's really difficult to keep up with the demand, and sometimes even prove ROI at that kind of expense. And I mean, no retailers really able to cope up with the problem. So when I look at large retailers, whether it is Walmart or eBay or Amazon, they are barely scratching the surface. So they might be just optimizing their top 1-3% of the content. Maybe mid-marketers might be able to do 5%, but that's pretty much it. That's where the problem really sits. So what really need to happen here, the AI and machine learning need to really tame this big data problem and put e-commerce, bring the efficiencies so where we can really able to produce this content using machine learning and AI, really a fraction of cost. And I'm not talking about evolution there where we can reduce the cost by 10, 20, 30%. I'm really talking about reducing the cost by 10 times, maybe 50 times. If you can bring the cost down to a dollar, then I can go to Walmart and I say, I can solve your all 10 million item problem in less than $10 million budget. That is the solution we need. When I look at the AI, I mean, everything can be measured, and I think this can bring the possible solution. Of course, I'd love to understand from you. So maybe let me dive in one segment at a time and some of the concerns. As a marketer, as a SEO, and when I talk to my colleagues, especially my past companies or with the current clients. So the very first thing, and then forget Google for a second or search engines, like really, is AI going to solve the findability and conversion challenge? So what do I mean there? The internal search is broken. In most of the e-commerce, only 30 to 40% SKUs are being found when customers are searching them. Why? Because these items are not described well. They do not have the right keyword the way consumers are searching, so they are never being found. And if we do something automated where we can inject some keyword or push some attributes, the content quality goes so poor, or it becomes so expensive, then the conversions suffer, and this problem is still there. Even after 20 years, every e-commerce suffers with this problem. So really, I mean, what AI can bring to the table?
I think there are two parts of the problem. When is the internal search, when you say internal search, number one thing is, first of all, the internal search engine, right, which some company has developed their own, Lucene-based, Indica, or many other, you know, search engines they are using internally. Many of them are not semantic-based search. What they find is a literal string match. Some are a little bit syntactical-based, so they can do a little bit better job. But still, this the true semantic ways where when you're putting a keyword, you do not look for that word, but you look for the intent. I mean, forget about this internal search. Google, the world's largest company, will be putting so much effort to bring that intent part out. I mean, they are doing it really good, but still they need to supply the context to drive that intent, right? The big problem is that one of the internal search is not semantic. So now if you don't have this semantic based search engine, what do you do? I mean, you cannot develop overnight or buy something, right? So you got to supply the enough data to your search engine. But now your search engine is whether literally string based or the syntax based or semantic based. You anyway have to supply the data. And the data is that, like you mentioned, that is a keyword or intent, right? Today, nobody talk about just a keyword or two keyword, you put in a three keyword, you talk about an intent. And the intent is created out of a cluster. We call it keyword cluster. So you give a bunch of keywords that gives that a search engine, whether it's Google or your internet, can drive a meaningful information. That's required. Now the second thing is that you give that cluster, how do you present that to the user when it comes to the product page, right? So what you need to do is you need to make sure that the keywords are presented to the user in such a way it does not look like it was stuck to the keyword at all. So the answer is, ultimately, the trick is that, you know, how do you really supply those keyword cluster, right, that helps the search engine? And the answer is give a meaningful and informative content on the page in a descriptive way. And this content often is given as a rich product description or Q&A nowadays. So if you write a product description in such a way that has all those informative elements and the keywords built in that and put something which doesn't make sense over there in the Q&A part, then you have a good product information. And then your internal search engine and external search, they both can drive a meaningful intent out of that. And that's where the AI content can help, because if you keep putting that everything manually, because your search criteria are changing, the customer intent is same, but the way they are asking the question is changing. And the way people search before for the same product versus now is different, right? So what you need a way where you can create that content automatically based on what's being searched inside and outside. And I think AI is a perfect fit for that. So AI content can really help. What it can do, it can learn from keyword cluster from various sources, like your search, Query database, Google keyword tool, third-party database like SEMrush or Ahrefs, and any other research information. And on the other hand, it can learn in the value proposition of the product. You know, and put the sentence together with this product and meaningful product information and that keyword cluster. That will not only help to increase the findability. When you have a meaningful, informative information, it increases the conversion because the customer likes it again. So AI can continuously modify, your product page content as it collects more information, user interaction, and customer reviews, customer support calls which you're receiving, and how your potential customer are looking for product external search.
So yeah, I mean, definitely when we talk about findability or searches, I think those seems like really the primary use case for the AI. And it's really come down to the learning data and the massive learning data from the customer themselves. So now let me take a step forward and really wear my SEO hat. And when any SEOs, and I talk to my colleague or the whole SEO industry, when we talk about like templated content or any kind of external content, really the duplication becomes a big issue. Google has brought Panda so many times just to really tail this problem. So the duplicate content, and that's what the industry was really behind for last almost, I'd say, at least 5 years, if not the 10. And all of a sudden, when we hear the AI, are we going in the same trajectory where we are going to see these duplicate content or templated content? If not, I mean, how different it?
Well, that's a very good concern, actually. And let me answer two things before I jump, like whether it's content. Will you create the duplicate or unique content? Let's touch base on this, the term you mentioned, the templated content and the smart content. So the first question is how template content is different from the AI content. But the template content obviously does not have context. For example, if you build the template product description for two similar products, decorated content easily lose the context and misrepresent the fact pretty easily. I mean, it's certainly a step toward the automation and good for reducing the effort to create, you know, multivariate kind of products, multivariate part of the product description to some extent. You know. But AI actually content, meaning you are talking about putting intelligence behind the content. The intelligence of explaining the value proposition, that's the intelligence. The intelligence of putting the value of information that matter to the customer. In AI content, you use combination of NLP, natural language processing algorithms, and knowledge graph to drive product information and create sentence to communicate relevant context to reader. So that's a fundamental difference, you know. So it's not like you took a piece of sentence and then you replace the variable in that. The machine literally understands the meaning, and that's we call it concept map or knowledge graph. What is the product really? Like a human does, or I mean, it's pretty simple to whenever you need to think about the AI, think about, you know, a 6-year-old or 10-year-old, how you teach them. So that's a different template. Now let's talk about the spinners. How fundamentally spinner works. Okay. So there are fundamental difference is how most of the spinner actually works in AI coming. Most of the spinner works out of synonyms of the word. Okay. They hardly understand the actual meaning of sentence, what is in the sentence. And what they produce is not very, very promising. And they sometimes mislead the information. So what happened, like literally you took them. So your objective is not actually give the information for, your objective is just to avoid it to create content. So that's a fundamental disconnect. So think like if you change this spinner to first understand the meaning of sentence and then use the right alternative sentence to communicate the same meaning in different brand voice, they will do produce the same content like AI, right? And I think that clarifies that why AI content would not be a duplicate or unique by its nature, right? I would say that, you know, with energy, natural language generation, knowledge graph, and the external data learning, AI will be able to produce really deep data-driven content, which may be more effective, unique, and accurate than the, you know, spun or templated content. You know, sometimes I feel, you know, even better than a human. I mean, the day will come when AI will assist human to create, you know, more informative and profitable.
So I love it. So again, not going in any definition. Basically, as a pure SEO, I need to think. You are saying that AI content will be borderless and the Google bot will not be able to spend. So really, my next question will be, how will AI content differ from human content? And what do I'm really trying to ask, like, would it be able to pretty much replicate the way human behavior is and the way human creates the content, which really look like creative, it compels and can connect with other people?
AI content and human content look same. They should not differ in terms of the video. But they differ actually in the way they have been created. The AI content is massively backed up by data. So it kind of performs better in that way. The reason is, this is very difficult and almost impossible for a human being to create that kind of content. Because AI has the capability to create, you know, and consume the unlimited data. One example is putting the information what customer is looking for, right? Since machine can collect multiple data points from competitor, Google, social channels, and learn what information people are really, really looking for, I mean, it can create a massive, big difference in terms of white creating the content. So on the one side, machine learn from the data and information that needs to go in the copy. Content. But on the other side, machine can take care of your brand voice to a large extent. So, I mean, when it comes to the human, I think the big thing a human can do today is actually be more creative. And, so when the human are more creative, you know, our idea is to put the AI along with the human. So, you use the human's best creativity in a machine continuously learning out of your creativity
and help you to bring that potential of the data what you have collected.
So what I'm hearing, like the machine will be able to produce even better content when it comes to performance.
Yeah.
But when you really want to touch the somebody's heart, right? And that creativity is needed. So combination will do. So that brings my next question. And this is like really, this is not only my voice. This is a voice from every client, every colleague who is a marketer or merchant. When we are talking anything around content, this is their number one concern. And some of them, even today, are holding large team of writers because this is so important for them, a niche player, like Brian was. They are not even letting the content go outside of their building. So to a third party agency or outsource or anybody, giving it to machine is really remote for them. Very high threats. I mean, would it be hold the brand?
Yeah, so I mean, when I see the AI, actually, it's like you are hiring another super writer, you know, whom you will be teaching. Like, so, I mean, I can tell you that right now, how it works, even in the CrewMachine, the bad voice part, is more or less full. So that's the reality. But and we are working, and many people out there are working, where we learn the brand voice from your expert. Today, what has to be done is the writers and the in-house folks, they actually train machine with the brand voice. But machine still works fine because it has been trained. It's again, it's not that huge effort. I mean, it's certainly a little bit of pain. You know, they need to spend, you know, creating and correcting the machine data. But eventually what's happening is we are writing those algorithms as well. That machine will learn the brand voice by itself. It'll identify that whether you speak aggressive or you be more salesy or you be more flowery voice and, or, you know, who, whether this is the UK English or the US English or what kind of audience you're talking to. So I fall back to, the semi-supervised learning part, you know, the brand must be able to fall into the same thing. You know, so you would continue to teach machine and machine. And that will make your content always unique from any other company. So you have your own, so that's where you will differentiate from your company. How your AI engine is, my AI engine is smarter than your AI engine. Right? It's like my writer is better than your writer.
Absolutely. So really bringing back the point of personalization, as I said, like current industry numbers are already that good personalization you have, it can create or enhance the sale by 70%. So really, the personalization is going to be a key for the future of e-commerce and how AI can help.
Certainly, the personalization is one of the big things, you know, which can change. I mean, you have Amazon Echo and Google, and this is not future, actually. You see that it's already there.
Sure. Right?
Talking about specific to content in e-commerce, before we are. Since AI can express it, you know, any possible data source, and use deep learning to correlate them, you'll be able to do wonders when it comes to this. Once these many dots are connected, including buying profile, social media, you know, their demographic, their age preference, what they buy, how much they earn, what their interest, you know, who are the family member, and any more thing, right? You put those two dots together, you know, you will be able to offer your customer much compelling experience than what is possible. I'm sure that you might have seen Salesforce Dreamforce recently, and how through their AI, which is the Einstein, they're able to give different experience. And the same thing we see here, you know, when it comes to personalized content, and the way I see is, you know, those old days when we go to the boutique store and the salesman who knows you from the last 20 years, he knows anything and everything about you. And when you go, he knew exactly what you would like, and he'll present you the way you like it. But that's how this whole e-commerce experience is going to be. I mean, the moment you land on the product, he knows everything about you. And it will speak the language, whether the product description or the information or the images shown over there is absolutely what you like.
So are you saying that the day is not too far when I can please my wife?
Absolutely. By the way, before you move forward, you ask a lot of questions. Let me ask the question.
Sure. Yeah.
So tell me, I mean, this is on a serious note. You have been in the industry in the past 10 years. You work in a big company and you have advised many small companies. I mean, do you see that this AI content, we are reducing the cost drastically, increasing the performance and everything. Since the cost is reduced, do you think that that will decrease the funding for the content project? You know, what do you think, you know, what will happen?
Yes, so I think when I think content, that's really not concerned with the project. There are a lot of fragmentation within an organization. They are spending a whole lot of amount of budget. It's just not counted as content. Somebody is counting it toward one bucket or something. But really, what problems you need to solve? So keep aside the market. The first thing, as I said, the internal search need to work. If your customer are not able to even find your product, I mean, that's what e-commerce is all about, right? So you need to fix that, right? If they find your product, they need to convert. You need to fix that. Then comes traffic, where the search engine are driving traffic and whole nine yards. Right.
So you're saying that, you know, this is not going to be only a SEO budget?
No. So this is like, I'll say like, once your infrastructure is there, the content is the second most expensive part and the most critical part. Now in terms of budget, if I take just the marketer budget, there is a budget set, and this, there are some legacy reason why there has been a budget and budget was sustained. Basically, the content or SEO were not very measurable, but that has changed. It's very measurable. In the industry, when I talk to any large client, the SEO or content is the one that budget produces the most ROI compared to whether it is social or other paid channel or Google AdWords and so on. And I'm not talking about 10-20% better. It's several 100% point better ROS when you look at the content. The only problem is the budget gets restricted, because if I'm paying $50 to create each item, there is only so much the rate of return I have. Then I start getting diminishing rate of return, then it's better to put in other channels. If you can bring the cost down from $50 to maybe $5 or $1, of course, the whole paradigm will change. I will be able to handle a lot more product, and so many products that I don't see in ROS today, or not enough ROS today, I think they will become a part of the whole thing. So I think the budget is going to increase. The content leaders, the number of people will be needed there, project manager will be needed there, all will increase, because right now only a fraction of percent, literally in one digit in terms of percentage, problem is being even touched by e-commerce. The rest 90-95% of the problem yet to be solved. So I think, I mean, I do not see any reason why the budget will be constrained.
That's good news.
So really, I mean, this is my next question, and I can give you some example, like what type of e-commerce content AI can produce. I mean, in e-commerce, we see product descriptions, buying guides, local pages, and so on. Where AI is really?
Yeah, sure. So I would say, you know, today is literally, as today, if you go by some system, you can do this. And today, AI can produce a very content that is attributed to you, and more or less a little bit repetitive in nature. Templated content, but some sort of repetitiveness is there. And in some example, like product description, category pages, they are very attribute data driven information. Buying guides, product comparison, those things are very local pages, infographics. Those are the things which are in. We have some of the clients who have like 5,000 students. They want like local pages. Very easy to teach machine about. Machine already know about the demographics information. Machine already know about the brand voice. Machine already know the value proposition, the product itself. You can put it together pretty easily and give you meaningful content. In future, I see that, you know, and very soon, this future is not like, you know, next 10 years, I would say that a year, 2 years, 3 years, time frame, are seeing that AI will be able to create or assist actually the creative content, like blogs or creative ideas, albums, those kind of things. And AI will also, I think AI can also, there are other piece which I hear a lot from the customer actually, and where AI can be more sophisticated. That is like, you know, creating the content for the different channels, the data for the multi-channel, meaning different devices, form factors, and at the same time, the different channel that you're selling, like whether you're selling on a website versus marketplaces or multiple marketplaces. Nowadays, we have many customers who sell on like more than 5 or 10 marketplaces. You've got to create the content for all the marketplaces. So those kind of things is very easy for AI to do today. So in the future, so I would say, you know, in future, I think, I would say this a doubt, but I would think, you know, many content, like even social media content, which marketers would want to automate from the, you know, from the communication perspective, that okay, they're launching the product, that they need to pass on the information, those kind of content would be pretty easy to do.
Perfect. So I think we have more questions around the visual content and videos and all that. I think we'll take them in the subsequent webinar since we are running out of time. So really, I mean, what Deepak has shared, we got a lot of very deep insights about AI. And subsequently, in this webinar series, we'll touch base other areas, especially in e-commerce, where we are going to see a lot of disruption, a lot more efficiency gain, better profitability, and how we can make this whole ecosystem better. And then we will also be discussing like really some of the deeper technologies and algorithm and how AI, how we can make it more powerful for your use cases. So what we have covered today, we really just touched the content problem and what AI can do there. But we strongly believe that anything which has attribute driven and at a scale, any issue in the e-commerce, whether it is a dynamic page creation, page reviews, image moderation, categorization, translation, they all are going to be solved by AI. So I don't think anybody has doubt, but really how faster, how better, how cheaper it will be able to solved. So I think we'll give you the state of the present and then near future where AI is going to land in the subsequent webinar. So I'll take just a moment to share all this AI, what it is going to influence within e-commerce. And again, I mean, pretty standard. We are going to see happy shoppers. We are going to see less customer returns. We are going to see cost economics, predictive data-driven mechanics, and many examples are, if I shop something in my neighborhood and 5 other people shop, Amazon already sent 50 items there because they think that if 6 people have bought from this neighborhood, there are possibility that another 40 people are going to shop, right? So all of a sudden, my 2 days delivery becomes 2-hour delivery. Meaningful conversions, customer loyalty, and so on, and I think we will go one item at a time in our subsequent webinar. So I'd really like to take a moment just to introduce the CrewMachine, which we are pretty proud of. It's our AI platform, AI and machine learning platform. And we are disrupting the e-commerce content. The key ingredient is like really the whole gap analysis, identify the content gap, fixes through AI machine learning, and then your crew, or you can leverage our crowd and really measure and track and feed all this back to the machine so the machine can learn and can produce data fast. A little bit deeper there, our vision is really to bring down the rich content cost by 1/10 by using AI and machine learning. And I think we are already seeing some very good results in limited categories. How this whole thing works, really, our engine crawl your sites, look at your internal data, your feed, then crawl the competitor, and then figure out the possible gap, content gap. And the content gap, which is going to produce ROI. keeping that in mind, our engine will also go learn from the market trends, what's selling now, what will sell in future, try to learn your brand voice, as Deepaka shared before, create the format and rules. You can customize some of them to collect the attributes from various data sources, whether it is GFK or GSI and so on. Once all of that happens, and create a copy using AI and machine learning. Once the content is generated, it is given to the human QAs, and they are working just so we can, so the machine can collect the training data. So if the copy passes through their QA without any edits, that's a pass. If it fails, then the data comes back to the machine. So the machine can learn and perform better next time. When the content is published, then we continue to measure the performance, and the performance measurement, all that data is feedback to the machine. So machine can do the job in the future. So I'll stop there, and I'll
ask a question.
Yeah.
Don't mind.
Sure, please.
So we're going to do a webinar on detailed demo of what really today product it is, and what, how it works, how people can try and you know, seeing the real product. Is there any place where they can contact to send the queries or
just send info at crewmachine.com. So yeah, so just send at info at crewmachine. I'll just type it here, and I think I'll love to take questions if you. Let me see if I can get a question. So the question started coming. So one question is there, like a really the customer want to know, and I think they belong to the power tool company. So they want to know, are you guys doing anything in the power tool area?
Yeah, so we are pretty much fixing all the categories in the e-commerce. So yeah, the power tool is one of the categories which we are building the knowledge graph. So yeah, all our customers who are selling our tools, they can get it.
Perfect. And the next question is that I'm really a small e-commerce. We have only a couple of $1 million in annual sales. Is this too much for me? I mean, should I really even worry about AI?
I mean, you should. You know, it doesn't matter. You know, first of all, the AI, you need to start learning about the AI part, right? How it can help. It's not about only that, you know, huge content creation, right? But suddenly get yourself in the door. I mean, today, AI has been democratized. No matter how small or big you are, I mean, you should get into that. And certainly, you know, today, a lot of application on creating the content is certainly a lot more valid for when you want to create the content at larger scale. If you have like a product or something, then certainly you may, creating the content today, I may not be the best way of doing it. But yeah, I know many of the actually our customers, those who have less than $1 million sales, I mean, they have like, you know, thousands of products, and for them, it's difficult to cope up with, you know, this AI technology.
Okay. The next question, it comes with somebody who is a Fortune 1000 retailer, and they're asking, like, the content is right now is produced at multiple places. The merchant creates some part, then the SEO team take over. They enrich it, and it's really fragmented and get very expensive. How you see the AI is going to help in this area and bring some efficiency?
Yeah, I think the two part of it, right? First is that, you know, data is spread all over, right? all over the organization, right? Sales team talking to the product team talking to the support team, and so on and so forth. So that's, it's very, very difficult to bring all the humans together. And AI, for that matter, is when you give a machine access to the different data points, machine is able to correlate all them and represent to the each of the party. And hence it connects them to each other and be able to bring. I mean, simple example, as I mentioned that, you know, I talked to some of our customers in the SEO or the marketing and say that how often you talk to the customer support. And the answer was surprising, actually. They don't even have access to the database where customers are putting their complaints. So those kind of things will go away. And certainly, you know, we would be doing much better.
Perfect. So I think I'm not sure if there is more time for the questions. Okay, so let's take the last question. There's only 1 minute left. Which algorithm you use AI content for AI content enrichment or product gap analysis? I think it comes from GVTase.
There are multiple algorithms actually. For the classification, for example, we use time-based algorithm for text generation, we have NLG, NLTK, and then that we have the n-gram algorithms and many others. So, and for product gap analysis is again that too. It is a part of combination. So we have many of our homegrown algorithms, which actually use multiple classification and segregation algorithms to generate the needed gaps.
All right. So I think we are pretty much to the end. It's 11 o'clock. So really, I'd like to appreciate the whole audience. We have a very engaged group. I hope you're able to learn something here. And many very good questions. So thanks a lot for participation. And look forward to seeing you guys again in the future webinar. And have fun. Holidays are pretty much to our heads. So happy holidays. Take care.
Thanks, guys.